morning, good afternoon, everyone. I am Emiliano Genorini, account manager for EMEA and LATAM in VIAVI. I am here with Dr. Oliver Mandal from Hellma. He's a part of Hellma solution, and he's the product manager for the spectroscopic probes and measurement cell. He is a very high qualified person. The target for the today presentation is the MicroNIR PAT-L, and Oliver for sure can give very important information in the regards of the, let's say, application and of the configuration of the probe. Oliver has a lot of experience in the pharmaceutical, in the chemical, and in the food market, and he has performed installation and supported the customer in achieving analytical goals for several years in several customers. I want to say thank you, Oliver, for being here with us.
Yeah, thank you for your kind introduction, Emiliano.
Thank you, and I will start the presentation introducing a bit our company. VIAVI solution has a quite long history, started back in 1948 as Oakley, producing specific coatings, and the coating technology is still nowadays our core competency. You can see here a little bit the history of the company. In a nutshell, VIAVI solution is now divided in two big groups. One is optical security and thermosmart product, where there is inside the MicroNIR spectroscopy, and the other group, NSC, that is related to the telecommunication market. We are present in over 100 countries. MicroNIR is a deal directly or through specific distributors, and let's say inside the OSP, apart from the MicroNIR, we produce also special pigment using to anti-counterfeiting the banknote. We produce filters that are used in the automotive market, consumer electronic market, government and aerospace solution. As I said, we have a very high optical competency in producing specific coating, and we have the capability of having a platform that is able to replicate very advanced, very high precision optical product. This is the DNA of the company. MicroNIR technology is something that is very innovative, because we can produce a very small sensor based on one of our core technology that is called a linear variable filter. Linear variable filter is a specific filter, very small, like the one that you can see here, that is a coating deposition on a glass substrate that enables the separation of the polychromatic light. As you can see in the picture here, polychromatic light is, in this case, the white light. And the white light is split into the different wavelengths that here are represented by the different colors, okay, without having any moving parts. And this is really the key point of our technology. In fact, let's say, we are able to create a very small sensor that has no moving part inside. The fact that we do not have any moving part inside means that this device is not subject to misalignment. It has an incredible high level of stability, and there is a high level of transferability between the two units. On top of it, we are not using any laser, and you know that the laser in a near infrared device is very often used in FT, is mandatory to be used in an FT and IR. And when you have a problem with the laser, the device stops and you need to replace the laser. Apart from the outage, because you need to have the part, you need to replace the part. If you don't have it, you need to order anyone. It's also important that in a pharmaceutical company, you are replacing one of the key components of the device. So apart from the cost of the part that you change, you have also the cost of revalidating the device itself. On top, we are using lamps for the light that they have about 40,000 hours of lifetime. That's an incredible level of performance because it means that you don't have to replace the two lamps, let's say, at least for 4 or 5 years. So it's something absolutely important in terms of having a device that has an outstanding level of stability. Another key point that I want to explain, and we will see later on, we have a device that is not just the probe, but the probe somehow it includes also the spectrophotometer itself. And this is something important because we don't need to have fiber optic. Fiber optic is something that you guys in the field are used to have, in this case are not necessary. But if you have fiber optic, you know pretty well that apart from the cost of installing the fiber optic, clearly they can be subjected to a damage or to a wear out, and also they, despite you try to do your best to keep low the OH content, a little bit of OH content is inside, and therefore they can be sensible to the temperature itself. Couple of words regarding our product line. This is the original MicroNIR called the 1700ES. That has been introduced back in 2012 and is a device working in reflection of the light that is connected with a cable to a computer. Nowadays, this device is offered mainly to the university with a special package and is also used by OEM customers that are building a complete solution around the small device in here. We have also a portable device that is the on-site W, Bluetooth battery power with a button that allows to start the measurement without having a software nearby. And the two process system that we had before the PAT-L, the PAT-U that is reflection mode and is static measurement point. Classical application are granulation drying, tableting, feed frame in a pharmaceutical production, and below you have the PAT-W that is the same device, reflection mode, so for products that are reflecting the light, wireless, and in this case is used for example, blending application in pharmaceutical market. The same are, let's say, available in the explosion proof configuration with the name PAT-U is PAT-UX, PAT-W is the PAT-WX, and for liquid, I am very glad to introduce you the PAT-L, that is the product that you have on the button, that is an immersion probe using a specific part that Oliver is going to explain in better detail in a while. We have also the possibility to have a bypass flow cell, done in collaboration with Nanosense, and in this case, again, it can be U or UX depending on the ATEX certification, and this is a transflection bypass. A little bit more details. So the PAT-U, let's say, even if it's a specific PAT, is in the backside of the probe. We have a cable that goes to a computer. This is a USB cable that can have a maximum direct length of about 3 meters, but eventually with the USB to Ethernet converter, you can go far. We have a purging port here that I want to immediately point out that you don't need to purge the device. Maybe Oliver can explain a bit more regarding this point, but the purge is only done during the assembly or during the maintenance of the device, and is necessary to avoid the condensation of the water vapor inside the probe. Well, we have also a measurement gap that can be highly configurable, and we will see in a while. Same device can also be available in the explosion-proof configuration, where we have clearly this part that is a standard PAT-L. We have a USB cable that goes to an intrinsic safety box, and from the intrinsic safety box, you can have an Ethernet cable that goes directly to your network, a cable for the power 24 DC, and eventually a trigger to start the measurement in remote. And this is ATEX certified. Just to summarize a little bit the product, we have here a video. Now it's gonna start. So you see here the PAT-L or eventually LX in case of emergency of immersion probe. You see that is one piece, so there is not a distinguish between the probe and the spectrophotometer, but is one part only. And clearly is enabled to be very robust. It can be done stainless steel or alloy. Is connected to our MicroNIR Pro software that, apart from acquisition of the data, is also good because it can be associated with the chemometric package to develop the method, and eventually to an OPC connection to, let's say, connect to a PLC and a DCS. Here is the how the device work with the linear variable filter that ensure an incredible high level of stability and performance over the time, cooling jacket in case you want to go up to 400 degrees, the immersion depth that you can see from the video can be completely configurable based on your on the need, as the optical path can be modified, as you can have a very wide choice of different flanges that you can attach to this device to connect directly to your reaction tank or to your tank in general. Just closing remark, the same device can also be available in the ATEX configuration. I leave now the microphone to Oliver, that is gonna dive you guys a little bit in more in the details of the probe.
Thank you, Emiliano. So hello, good morning and good afternoon, everyone, but also provides different kind of probes and measurement cells. Since many years now, there's a broad range of products. And what I would like to concentrate now on is the probe shown here on the right side. What you can see here, that's the standard probe. And the one that is used with the VIAVI instruments that derives from that standard probe, which is proven technology with a very rugged design, and that's easy to integrate due to the different kind of process adapters that Emiliano also mentioned. So what's special is a metal, sealing, which is here right in the head next to the windows. It's gold coated, and with that it's very stable against chemical substances. It's also very temperature and pressure resistance. So with that metal coating, you have very high chemical resistance. You have temperature resistance up to 400 degrees Celsius. In Hestelloy, it can go up to 300 bar, and the optical setup fits optimal to the VIAVI instrument. There is a optical connection at the bottom to the instrument. Then there are light guides, guiding the light through the measurement slit here at the top. And the entire probe is purged with nitrogen. That's done once in production. And that then when in use, you don't have to care about it anymore. It has a slight overpressure. It prevents moisture to settle down or to influence your spectrum. And it's also providing a second barrier. So in any case, if the probe would be destroyed here in the front part in your production, it's still safe and chemicals cannot get outside. If you want to get a closer look at the different options which are available, you could take a look at the configurator of Hellma, which is online. There you will find the Excalibur HD FPT. You can find any kind of technical information that might be needed. And you can also play around with the different options. So that's the path lengths that can be changed. Also the materials from stainless steel to Hastelloy. The process connections, and so on. Thank you very much.
Oliver, I come again in the stage. Thank you for the presentation. And let's go to see a couple of applications that we can do with the MicroNIR PAT-L liquid probe. So let's see if I'm gonna be able to share the screen. Yeah, so this is a key point that I want to let's say discuss together. When we have a liquid, I mean clearly a very important point, there are two important points to take in account. One is the path length that we are using. The second is the geometry that we are gonna use. Let's start from the path length. The path length, I mean, we need to go back to the Lambert-Beer law that basically you have a lamp that is emitting a certain intensity of the light. It goes in a sample. This is basically a cuvette, okay? And you have a sensor that is measuring the delta between the light coming and the light that goes out from the sample itself. Clearly, there is a relationship. Absorbance is material. This is characteristic of the specific material by the path length, by the concentration. So one very important parameter to play with is the length of the cuvette, so the path length of the cuvette, no? And clearly is also important to define the selectivity, because clearly if I increase somehow the path length, I increase the capability to be sensible to a specific material, but if I go too much farther, the risk is that I get a saturation of the signal. So I need to balance between the two. Therefore, we normally suggest to have path length as higher as possible, as larger as possible, in case you want to analyze something that is not absorbing much. I have in mind like oil, for example. And to find a way to reduce as more as possible compatibility with the process, let's say, situation that you have, the path length in case you have a water-based solution. Clearly, the water is absorbing a lot because we know that the NIR spectrum depends from the, let's say, variation of the dipole moment. Therefore, water is the molecule that has probably the highest dipole moment in the world. So that's why it's very high in terms of absorption, and so we need to reduce the path length. Saying that, the message is we need to find the right balance to find the right path length. The second point is it better to work in transmission or in reflection? Well, that's a little bit chicken and egg. The PAT-L is working, PAT-L and PAT-LX, they are working in transmission, and it's clear that transmission for a transparent liquid is always better than transflection. Transflection, that means, transmission means that you have, let's say, the let's say lamp, the light goes into the sample, and basically the MicroNIR is acting as just a detector that is recording the absorbance. Reflection means that you have, or transflection, you have, let's say, your sample. Here you have the two light that are on, like in reflection. The light goes on the sample, and behind there is a sort of mirror that is reflecting the light back. Clearly, in case you have something very opalescent, very, I would say, difficult in terms of light transmission, okay, this second geometry is preferred. Clearly, in our case, we also need to compromise between the PAT-L that goes absolutely well into a tank, even if can be applied in a pipe. The flow cell is only for a pipeline. There are two applications that I want to mention that we believe that are pretty interesting and that we have already done in the past a few times. One is the solvent recycling, because clearly, let's say, the use of organic solvent, it's really important in a chemical and a pharmaceutical plant. The having the possibility to recycle the solvent, it saves a lot of money, and it also allow to have a sort of green chemistry that is very cool nowadays. One of the examples here is the water into a specific solvent. Water in ethanol, water in other kind of solvent. You can clearly see here that we have created, let's say, different spectra, different sample with different concentration. And here you see around 1428 in this area that there is an increase exactly of the water peak. And this is a proof of concept that we made recently for a customer with a very demanding lower limit from zero to a little bit more than 1000 ppm, and you can see here the linearity. Another application is this one, where we worked on a API purification. Basically, there is a process where the API is purified, and we want to make sure that out of this purification step, we have only a specific substance and not the mix between the two. In this case, we have here a Natex device installed, and we started with, in the beginning, actually, it's a nice story because we started in the laboratory with a laboratory equipment, with a portable system, and we made some trials. And basically, you can see that from the beginning, where there is only methanol, here is the top, where there is the more of the product getting out, and the bioproduct is in this direction. You can see in the PCA, as is very clear, the transition between substance A, substance B, and substance the API that is in this area here. This is an exploratory approach based on the PCA, but this part can also be easily turned in a quantitative model where, for example, you can, let's say, take the spectrum, go to the laboratory, do the wet chemistry, and basically you can make a PLS correlation and see the outcome result. In this case, is a nice correlation with a very low error. That's all from our side. Please, the presentation is completed. Please, we kindly ask you to type your question, if you have, in the Q&A box, not in the chat, please. And we will try to respond. We'll stay online another 10-15 minutes, as long as we have questions, and we'll try to respond to all the questions of general interest, And if we have no time to reply to a single question, we will, let's say, promise that we reply to all the questions in written by the end of the week. We will also provide an anonymized copy of the Q&A section later on. So feel really free to ask questions to us in the Q&A box. Forgot this point, you will get a link for the survey. Please participate to the survey. That is really important for us to understand where we have to improve our presentation.